on family, work, social inequalities, and the social role of women and young people. From 1999 to 2011, she taught sociology and history of work and sociology and history of the family at the universities of Florence, Urbino, and Siena. And she is a founder, one of the founders, of the Italian Association of Women Historians. So please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you for the invitation. I apologize for my English, and I ask you some more patience, okay? The focus of the theme of this meeting, the study of working women in the North Adriatic area during the post-war transition of the last century, is of great interest. This approach allows us to understand how the influence of political ideologies and regimes is giving a political and social value to women labor. In my abstract, I proposed to refer to Italian history only and underline some points which should be useful for a comparison with Northern Adriatic regions that after World War II became part of communist Yugoslavia. But I realized that it was impossible to do so without dealing almost superficially with some point of Slovenian history. So I hope that my thoughts will rise a debate, because surely I will be superficial in my relation with Slovenian history. Women's labor and women's rights since first modern to recent years have been characterized in Western Europe by a squeeze box movement. But the rural world in contemporary times was more stable in its values. In Italian, as in Yugoslavian North Adriatic regions, patrilinear peasant families, mainly steppe families, were common. Their gender cultures were hierarchical, traditional, and patriarchal. What does this mean in terms of moral norms and expectations on women's work? Referring to Italy, who have some interesting information taken from oral history regarding the position of women in rural families after World War II. The condition of peasant women was scarcely improved with respect to the 19th century and was still extremely heavy, based on the old idea that women were inferior human beings with the related expectation of very hard women's work and of intense deference due to the men of the families. They had to work longer than men and try to be as strong as a man to be accepted in husband households. Deference toward men was emphasized by their actions in everyday life. In many families, the women were permitted to be seated at the table with their husbands. In addition, peasant women were also expected to perform tasks that exemplified the symbolic deference, as, for instance, shining their husband's shoes. In this sense, we have an eloquent personal account recorded by Piero Brunello in Veneto. The wife of a repetin, a jack of all trades, in a village on the plains near Treviso, explained her choice of a more impoverished lifestyle as opposed to marrying a peasant farmer. A peasant's wife is always working out in the fields. She works harder, from dawn to dusk, and his words often a beast of burden. And when she returns home, her little baby has his ears filled with tears from all his crying. In peasant families, the woman has to honor her husband and his family, including her father-in-law, calling him sir, and comparing the mother-in-law to the Holy Virgin. But those other called me, you woman, too femina in Veneto. And at lunchtime, the men of the table with their hats and their woman with their apron, and the children in her arms out of a porch or sitting on the stairs that went to the bedrooms. If it's too boring, you can read without. Okay. In urban areas, it was difficult for newly immigrated peasants women to find stable jobs, due mainly to their low level of education. But the condition of housewife was considered good in comparison with that of a rural worker in terms of a lighter work pattern, in being able to devote care to her children, and in the quality of intimate relations. This is what the peasant farm woman, born in 1943, said when interviewed by Nuto Revelli at the beginning of the 80s. If I would have the possibility of doing it over again with the experience of what I've been through, I wouldn't remain in the countryside for anything. I prefer marrying a humble factory worker because the life of a farm woman is too much of a sacrifice. 90 of 100 women on farms have to work in the fields and also take care of the home. Instead, a city woman, the wife of a factory worker, only needs to think about being a homemaker. A city woman, when she has 10 minutes of free time, can read the newspaper. She can fiddle around a bit, allow herself a bit of luxury, dress like a lady. Not live the kind of life I lived. When my children were small, I abandoned them under the tree while I worked, while I gathered the hay. Would I want to see my daughter live a life like that? And so I underline the fact that there is a big debate about the success of breadwinner ideology between women, but I think that the countryside women coming to the town were happy of changing their style of life. The Yugoslavian Socialist Constitution of 1945 gave equal rights to both men and women, not only in the economic and political spheres, but also within the family, equal and shared responsibilities and power, in Italian potestà, of mothers and fathers in deciding about their children's lives. All this was conquered by Italian women in 1975, with the new family rights. But I suppose that inside the peasant family, women's experience was similar in Slovenia to that of peasant Italy. I ask confirmation to the colleagues who are here and have research experience on such topics. These peasant Slovenian women didn't choose or can escape rapidly from countryside. In fact, the proportion of rural activities in socialist Slovenia was even more than double that of Italian North Adriatic regions like Friuli, Venezia, Giulia. Now I show you a figure, and there was also the last census, but it disappeared in the slide. Anyway, you see, you will see after that the situation is quite stable during the socialist period and changed very rapidly after. How now the socialist laws were able to change the subordinated conditions of peasant Slovenian women? My supposition is that countryside remained in Slovenia as in Italy, far from the state. What happened in the industrial sector? Here I have the figure of Slovenia and Friuli, Venezia, Giulia. The change in sectorial labor quotas seem to have been different in Friuli and Slovenia, and when in Italy, in Trieste, in Friuli, the weak industrialization that there was declining, Slovenia was in their upswing, as you see. The working class in the Trieste and in Friuli regions was occupied in heavy industry, mainly in shipbuilding, and had a male profile. The wives of the workers were mainly housewives. I refer to a thesis by a student, Omon Falcone, but I haven't the time to check the exact referee. This generation of working husbands, wives, apparently accepted the condition of housewives and male breadwinner ideology, but it was the source of hidden, in my opinion, it was the source of hidden frustration. In my opinion, such frustration was recognized and refused by their daughters, more educated and near to enter in the expanding middle class. In the 60s, tertiary service activities were growing in Italy, absorbing young male and women. But while peasant women were becoming housewives, joining a new way of patriarchal subordination, a new generation of urban middle class wives tried to transform this traditional bourgeois pattern, negotiating parity inside the family couple on an individual level. This is the graphic of other activity, tertiary activities, but now we go on. And we refer to this hidden negotiation in the family during in the middle class during the 60s. As Enrico Asquith showed in her study about Sardinia and Milan, to build a nuclear intimate family was in fact in the 60s the objective of a number of Italian middle class married women. They were willing to gladly accept the condition of housewives, given the condition that the husband balanced these with signs of their love and the recognition of their value. This had to be demonstrated by the males renouncing their traditional separate male sociability. That was the main ground of this fighting. Shared leisure and holidays, shared interest and daily dialogue. As Bergman wrote, the core of Western feminism was simply the refusal of a private, invisible sphere. Theoretically, it should be the basis of individual freedom, but in daily life it was the grounds of a persistent and equal gender freedom. Sexual freedom in particular was recognized as the key to female liberation. The majority of girls involved in feminism in the 70s thought that sexual liberation and parity in the family were public matters. In Italy, the struggle for legal abortion became a part of vindication of sexual freedom and control over their own bodies. Groups of self-awareness were the basis of feminist practice. Here is the photo of a manifestation. And just a few small groups like Lotta Feminista, Feminist Struggle in Italy, paid attention to the division of labor in the family. In the 60s and 70s, what were the ideas of Slovenian women regarding parity in the family and in the public sphere? In fact, the quota of rural workers was still high, but the working class was growing, and it was much more feminine, more educated, and endowed with greater economic and civil rights than the Italian one. The passage from the rural world to the industrial one did not mean here the spread of the ideology of male breadwinner. This is an hypothesis. I have not researched about this, but I think passing from a high level of activity in the countryside to high level of activity in the industry, the bourgeois ideology of domesticity didn't radicate itself in such region. This is the core of this thinking, because I have not researched, but I am theoretically sure of it. It seems to me very important, because the male breadwinner ideology is mainly a bourgeois or middle class ideology linked to the period of industrialization. The political ideology that looked to workers as an ungendered working class, that many feminist historians have underlined, coincided in fact with the weakness of the absence of the bourgeois moral norms of a male breadwinner. What about Slovenian women's subjective perceptions? On such a theme, due to my scarce knowledge, I will simply propose a set of hypotheses. In fact, I suppose that these different stories in terms of work experience, education, and endowment of rights produced different feelings. My hypothesis read in a different way respect to peasant women, working class women more educated and able to communicate among themselves, became conscious of a wide set of constitutional rights assets in 1945. Such rights were equal power in the family, the right of abortion, the right to be assisted in their family tasks by social service. I don't know how much really operatives they were. More, the socialist ideal relative to a woman home worker was that she was a sort of rational and efficient engineer. My question is now, more quiet tensions in Slovenian homes. In this framework, I wonder if negative aspects, a still high quota of rural population, with its patriarchal values, the positive ones, constitutional, political, civil, and social rights, and specific aspects, characteristics of communist society, in existence of the male breadwinner vision and limited quota of middle class members, concurred to create in Slovenia in Slovenian women a feeling of economic and social gender equality. This set of reasons probably blocked the potential conflict in various aspects of family life, from sexual double standards to persisting male society to an equal division of labor. These are hypotheses, just hypotheses. Okay. Vettilli and Scott, 1978, idea that in the working class family cooperative values prevailed over conflict should be correct for these workers? Question mark. Yes, they give this picture, but it's not realistic for Italy. And I ask if it was realistic for Slovenian women. The hypothesis that I have advanced in the previous slides is that the communist period, in the communist period, Slovenian women, distant from Western middle class views, accepted the hidden inequalities of private intimate life, and also if they didn't accept, I don't know if they accepted, did not consider it as a public issue. At the slides that I showed reveal, the post-communist transition was very rapid in economic terms. From 1991 to 2011, the shift of active population toward tertiary activities accelerated and converged with Friuli's data. The idea of a regression of Slovenian women's rights proposed by feminist literature in the 90s seemed to me, anyway, only a part of the reality. European Values Surveys 208, I used this and I'll show you some results. Slovenian women seemed very interested in equalitarian family relations and in distancing themselves from the male breadwinner model, and they seemed to be much more advanced than in Italy. Here we can see the last results, unfortunately, is 208, not the last wave is not finished. One very eloquent question is if a preschool child is likely to suffer if his or her mother works. Italy's responses were largely positive. They stayed in the range just under Azerbaijan and Turkey, with little difference between males and females. Slovenia was, on the contrary, in the group of northern countries. The bigger difference between males and females is quite surprisingly shared with top gender equality champions such as Norway, Sweden, Finland, Denmark, revealing perhaps a female dissatisfaction or a normative equalitarian aspiration. Slovenia was, on the contrary, no, questo l'ho già detto, it revealed perhaps a daily female dissatisfaction, questo l'ho già detto. Oh, this is the slide, Now, here we see, the question is percentage of people that agree or agree strongly with the statement that a preschool child is likely to suffer if his or her mother works. In Italy, you see, after Azerbaijan and Turkey, there is Italy, and there is a balanced opinion between women, and women are convinced too. To evaluate their role of mothers. Slovenia is very, very distant. and she is near the group of Western Nordic people, the so-called champions of parity. And what we can notice that in this group there is more difference between women and men, which seems to be interesting. And so I don't know if it refers to a reality of sector division of work, or, as I think, to a more a major sensibility to the theme. These nations, women are more sensible. A slightly different profile appears in the response to the question of sharing household chores. Is very or rather important for a successful marriage. Italy was at the bottom of the range with identical responses for men and women, various positions underneath Slovenia. Slovenia's women seem to be more sensitive to this item than other ex-Yugoslavian women, not far from Nordic countries, but also in this case, Slovenians men were 6 points behind, suggesting a conflict about gender opinions, which is even more profound in another small ex-Yugoslavian nation, Bosnia and Herzegovina. Allora, this is the. Non capisco dove. I don't find Italy. Ma perché mi va via I sia no I don't find but there is perhaps it's at the bottom.
Yeah, the table doesn't show the bottom.
Sì, si è tagliata. Anyway, Italy. Ah, no, this is another. This is after. Okay. Italy is exactly at the bottom, it's the last one. Women in parliaments. Finally, we will examine the public aspects of gender empowerment, real and recent data about women's presence in European parliaments in 2019. Here we see, as a set of articles by feminist historian underlined, a low presence of women in ex-communist countries, including Slovenia. Italy, in 208, reached levels not so distant from those of Northern Europe. Italy is 36%, not so far from France, Denmark, yes, far, really far, because she doesn't touch 40%. But in the middle, Slovenia with 28 is another range. All the social, the ex-socialist, ex-communist little states or nations are around 20%. Slovenia is not so low. Now, to conclude, I try to say something about this evidence, but something not so definitive. I leave to you the interpretation. I don't have an answer, and I leave it to your reflections. I will simply advance a point. While Italian women seem in 208 to accept more than others the male breadwinner vision, but appear quite strong in the political sphere, the Yugoslavian case seems to be the opposite. We see in the two cases a contradictory reality in relation to degrees of private and public empowerment. We call also reduce that political presence of women, that political presence of women depends on exquisitely political processes. Sovereign values prevailing today in ex-communist countries seem to be the result of the transition that brought to parliaments a majority of leftist nationalistic members, which is incompatible with women's presence, not compatible with women's presence. But we can also imagine that the idea of emancipation prevailing in different countries depends on their history. In Italy, where feminist tradition is more present, political struggle is perhaps a more valued item, even if coexisting with maternal ideologies. Questions, not affirmations. In socialist country, women are perhaps more interested in social objective of gender equality in work, but show less interest to politics. I have not an answer. I thank you really very much for your attention.